make some drink.
This is Deontay the Bronze from the Wilder. Heavyweight champion of the world.
Right? We on.
And you're watching Real Showtime, Fans, baby. Real Talk.
Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Where orthodontist Trip Young and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro Mark for stats, man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Real Fans, RealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Is Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor, tell a Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter, tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified co-sign, you know what I'm about, son. Real Fans, RealTalk.com. I'm out, one. Real Fans, Real Talk. Real Fans, Real Talk. Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Real Fans, Real Talk. Real Fans, Real Talk. Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Real Fans, RealTalk.com.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another live episode of Real Fans, Real Talk. I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. We got a great show lined up for you tonight. And my t-shirt for the day is "This Team Makes Me Drink." A lot of you Knicks fans will probably understand that with all the stress going on with the New York Knicks for a very long time. We also got our blogger here, Eric Sanchez, just posted a new blog on the realfansrealtalk.com website. A lot to talk about in the world of sports. Before we get into all that, let me introduce my co-host, the one and only Trip Young. What's going on, Trip?
I'm in a good mood, Statman. Not because I drink, because I no longer have to drink because I get the natural buzz at watching the Knicks fold and continue to just do worse and worse. And here's the thing, Statman. And I got to say this. You know, it was maybe like a couple of years back. You know, I think when Tracy McGrady still played for the Knicks, right? I think I was at the point where I just felt really, you know, bad for the Knicks. They were so horrible. I just felt bad. And I guess, like, you know, the New York pride in me just wanted them to just do something. You know what I mean? And then, you know, I got over it after a while. But I was just about to that point last week. And then your man James Dolan goes and throws my guy Charles Oakley out of the garden. And then I just, you know, just no longer, I don't even feel sorry for the Knicks anymore. I just laugh. I'm actually happy that this stuff is happening to the Knicks organization because they are truly, truly hopeless. And they are not going to win a championship ring as long as James Dolan owns the team. So I'm happy. I'm really happy.
I mean, thanks
for branding our spirits, Trip. We really appreciate it. Yeah.
You know, first of all, shout out to Wifey for Lifey, you know, Serena. We didn't really get to talk because we haven't been on the air. You know, she won, you know, Australian Open, you know, greatest of all time right now. And then just the fact that I get to celebrate this with you guys as Knicks fans, I get to just, I just love it when it's the tension, is everything is just so great, fellas. You know, you guys truly suck. I think
it really is a special type of hater to actually enjoy what's going on here with Charles Oakley and the Knicks.
No, I don't enjoy what's going on with Charles Oakley. I just enjoy what's going on with the Knicks in general. First of all, Oakley is my man. That's one of the greatest Knicks. I don't care what anybody says, stats, whatever. Charles Oakley is one of the greatest Knicks, you know, and he played for the Knicks organization at a time where, you know, the Knicks really meant something to basketball. Like now, you know, the Knicks are a joke. Just flat out. But he played during a time where, you know, in the 90s, you know, it was still cool to be a Knicks fan, even though they didn't win any championships. But you had, you know, those four guys with Ewing, Oakley, you know, Mason and Starks. They really meant a lot to New York City. So to have James Dolan do something like that to Charles Oakley, I'm just completely done with James Dolan. So I can't, nah. But everything else, yeah, hilarious.
Welcome back to the program, Eric. You just recently posted a blog today.
Yes, I did on the
Oakley situation. You want to elaborate on that for the fans that haven't read it yet?
Absolutely. I mean, some of it is piggybacking off Tripp's comments, but the organization is a joke. They're more concerned with ticket sales and celebrities sitting at press row as opposed to the product on the court. And these are the type of things you get, you know, when you're worried about image as opposed to the quality of the team that you put out there. This is what you're going to get.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's really a bad time to be a Knicks fan. I've been rooting for the Knicks over 20 years. I can't remember it ever being this bad. where one of our legends is getting thrown out of the arena. Our president of basketball operation doesn't want to address the media.
Special type of hater right here.
I love it. I'm sorry, man. Hey, listen. You know what? On the bright side, New York is about getting money and getting fly. So at least a $3.3 billion, the highest valued franchise in all of the NBA with 3 years running now, at least you live in that New York state of mind. You're making
that
money.
That actually makes it worse.
It does make it worse because the fans aren't boycotting anything. They're all, they're still selling out 80% of the games, as you mentioned in your blog, and it's still a tough ticket to get even though they're losing. I mean, it's just mind-boggling.
Listen, you are absolutely
right. I understand it because like Eric and myself, there are loyal Knicks fans that just will stay with them no matter what, as opposed to guys like you who just, every time there's a new hot player, well, they'll go from, Iverson to LeBron James. The team always changes depending on where a player is. So,
the team doesn't change. It's always about Brooklyn. That's number one. Now,
Brooklyn didn't even have a team before.
Exactly.
So
now it's just, that's the team. Brooklyn is just the team. As long as
the
team is Brooklyn.
The hat that you have on your head right now, that you don't root for them anymore?
Once again, New York is about getting money and getting fly. So, yes, I support my man LeBron James. So, I'm by the hat. You know what I mean? I support whatever team he's going to. I want that team to win. Now, the Nets, that's just a home team. That's a Brooklyn thing. So, one of my people posted on Facebook today, what did he say? I do things different because I'm from old Brooklyn. So, yeah, that's what it is. So we always going to support Brooklyn,
The Brooklyn Nets are new Brooklyn because they came to Reese's.
But they here. You know what I mean? Just like I always say, if the Yankees aren't in it and the Dodgers are, I take the Dodgers because they from Brooklyn. So that's just what it is. Listen, that's how we do. Mm. All right, but now listen. First of all, shout out to the Nets, man, because we did get the honor. Thanks to some friends to get over to a Nets game and sit very some very good seats and then really enjoyed the game. They didn't win, but
surprise.
Yeah, exactly. That's not a surprise to me because they don't have a team at all. So I'm not even surprised at that. But that's just a Brooklyn thing. So shout out to
Dimwitty.
Dimwitty was beasting though. You can't don't front on Dimwitty.
Anybody who got to connect on a Sean Dimwitty jersey, hit up Trip because that's his new favorite player.
After Braun. You can't even tell me Dimwitty wasn't balling though. 17 on him.
Stop. 17. That was career high for him.
17 on the Grizzlies. That's the Grizzlies though. They play good defense. 17.
The Grizzlies' second option was Vince Carter. Vince Carter's only
that's true. And
on two bad knees at 41 years old.
Listen, that's Vince Carter. That's a legend, man. You got to give him his due. Look where he's at on all time scoring list. He's still knocking him down.
He probably could be the number two option on Brooklyn right now.
I'm pretty sure he could be, but that's neither here nor there.
Sean
all right.
Dinwiddie.
Listen, I'm telling you, watch. Listen to that name, Dinwiddie. Watch on my son. He's about to blow up Shue. It's about to go down. Watch in 3 years where the Nets gonna be at. I'm telling you, it's gonna be crazy.
Nets don't have any first round picks, so they'll be right.
I said in 3 years it's
they'll
gonna take
right
a while
right
to
now.
Get back to the right to the promised land. All right. Listen, like I said, listen. It's not at least we losing because we know why we losing because the team just sucks. Y'all losing with four All Stars. A defensive player of the year, an MVP.
Well, technically, we only have one All-Star.
Yeah, we have one All-Star.
Which wasn't even named an All-Star until recently. So,
yeah, he just got on. Well, I didn't mean that. I'm just saying in general, these are All-Stars. They've made All-Star appearances. And, we got
Porzingis
an MVP. You got a defensive player of the year. Porzingis played in the rookie game.
The rookie game? That's not an All-Star.
Yeah,
They play All-Star weekend, So, hey, listen. That's like baby all stars, that's like the D League for the NBA, the rookies and.
It's not the same thing. It's a bunch of young guys who haven't developed their talent yet.
Hey, listen, Towns played and he's definitely doing his thing right now. He's been balling since he came in, so you get a few at the rookie sophomore game. You know what I mean,
they don't even call it that anymore, right?
The Rising Stars Challenge. But what are you gonna do? I'm looking forward to all of that. But But back to these Knicks and how sorry you guys are, which I just want again, Statman, this is probably the favorite, you know, of your collection. I think this is my favorite shirt, outside of when you get to wear the "it's a LeBron thing, you wouldn't understand" t-shirt. But I really like this one because, I mean, yo, the Knicks are just sorry right now, man. And how could you do that to my man Oakley, Statman? Could you call Dolan or something and talk to him, man?
I mean,
he's getting out of line.
He won't listen to anybody.
He disrespectful on the. From the top of the Knicks organization to my man Oakley. You got Phil throwing Carmelo under the bus any chance he can get. Like, I don't understand what's wrong with the Knicks. Why can't you guys do anything right?
Well, it seems like we're cursed or something.
Yeah,
I'm
not
sure.
From the top. If these are the type of things that your owner condones, it's going to trickle down through the rest of the organization. It starts at the top.
And as I post on social media sharing Reggie Miller's comments, for future free agents, how does it look like when, and I'm paraphrasing here, when you treat your former legends like that and you're throwing your star player under the bus constantly, referring to Carmelo Anthony. So, and it's a very good point, and we've talked about that before. You know, the New York is a big market, and we always think that we could attract big free agents, and we never do.
Unless you're the Yankees.
I mean, referring to the Knicks, you know, obviously. You know, other teams, that's a whole different story. But the Knicks, you know, franchise, I mean, people kind of know about that, and people know that playing in New York is tough, and you're going to get thrown under the bus, and Carmelo Anthony is a perfect example of that, you know, because they're just, you know, pretty much blaming everything on him. And, you know, Phil Jackson still determined to trade him. And Phil Jackson is looking like he's going to be with the Knicks for a couple more years. I mean, before this season started, I mean, I would say both of us were hyped up with, he made some decent moves. I mean, it sounded like, you know, Joakim Noah and Rose and, you know, Melo and Porzingis, that's, you know, a nice lineup right there. But
now I just want to drink now because it's just ridiculous. It truly is with these guys, man. You're absolutely right. When it comes to the Knicks, for whatever reason, we bash our star athletes. And Melo is no exception. And that was just, it's beyond words, beyond explanation at this point, that Phil only tweets when it's about Melo. Phil won't address to the media.
Well, I think he wants to trade Melo, and the only way he's going to do that is if Melo's fed up with the Knicks enough.
But are they like in a middle school relationship where he's waiting for Melo to break up with him?
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, you're not doing anything but lowering his trade value with all of his stuff. Like, it's either if you're not going to trade Melo,
constantly going out there putting up numbers. So I mean, his trade value. Yeah. You know, he's not exactly, you know, a Joakim Noah where there's a contract. Like, he's a max contract guy.
Yeah,
so
but
it's not
still
like
gonna,
a bad contract that you got to swallow to take him.
Yeah, you're still getting a good player, but they're gonna still try to give you the short of the stick because they know what's going on with the Knicks. It doesn't matter.
Give us, if we came to the table with Melo and we're going to move Melo at this point, what team is going to give us a first-round pick or any value knowing we don't want him?
Yeah. The nut is not.
We've tarnished his reputation. We've made him seem as just a selfish ball hog who only cares about his stats. So what playoff team is going to say, "Yeah, let me get Carmelo Anthony, and I'll throw you some young players in a first round pick"?
They were talking about J.J. Redick and Austin Rivers for Carmelo Anthony. That doesn't sound right on any planet, any way you look at it. Like this, like you're talking about a top 10 player, one of the greatest offensive players in the game still right now.
Yep.
But we're talking about giving up J.J. Redick and Austin Rivers, and that's what you're going to get for Melo? Like talking about a Cavs trade that doesn't involve Kevin Love for Melo? Like all of these places where they're not even throwing in any superstars and nothing in the deal. It's just like you're going to take what we give you.
Bottom line, there's no trade happening. There's no trade happening.
Yeah, so. I doubt it's going to happen. I mean, you've only got a couple more weeks to...
Like, why are we still dragging this out? Like,
well, because the trade deadline's still not done, so of course he's going to be open to other options. But, I mean, Redick and Rivers, that trade didn't happen because it's not realistic. Like, otherwise, the Clippers didn't say no to that, you know? So, obviously, Phil Jackson wasn't okay with it. I mean, he probably wanted another player from the Clippers, DeAndre Jordan. I don't know where those rumors came about, because if that trade was legit, Carmelo Anthony would agree to it to play with Chris Paul, DeAndre Jordan, and Blake Griffin.
I don't know.
And you know, the Knicks get basically nothing. The Clippers would have agreed to it. Melo would have probably agreed to it. So the only,
we're used to the Knicks getting absolutely nothing.
Nah, I don't know about that though, because at the time when that rumor came out, Paul was already hurt and Griffin was just coming back. So it wasn't like their team was set and they were running and they were healthy. They were still
they'll probably be set next year.
No, because
Chris Paul's contract is.
So if you're Melo, what sense does it make? Melo goes over there, then they could probably only keep one of those guys.
Yeah.
They won't be able to keep both.
With Melo's contract.
Yeah, with Melo's contract, along with any other pieces, because now you're going to have to deplete your bench to be able to get Melo. Yeah. So I don't think it made much sense there either. No trade is going to happen. The only team that really has the pieces to make it happen would be Boston. They're the only team. And Danny Ainge is very smart. He's not going to gut his team just for the sake of saying, I brought in Carmelo Anthony.
Yep.
They're talking right now about getting Jimmy Butler, and they're giving up far less than we would be asking for Carmelo Anthony.
Yeah.
So they're the only team that can make it happen.
It's on Phil, man. Phil, like at some point, you know, greatest coach of all time, arguably, I think he is. But, you know, everybody that can play basketball can't coach, and everybody that can coach can't be a GM. Like, it doesn't always work out that way. And he has not done a good job at all. Like, I mean, he's pretty much hanging his hat on Porzingis. Other than that, like, what has Phil actually done?
That was a good pick when no one really agreed with him. He picked up Derrick Rose, which turned out to be pretty good, even though the Knicks can't seem to win. But Rose is playing well.
He is playing well,
but
he's
playing for a contract, obviously. But
you're still not getting MVP Derrick Rose. So that's what I'm saying.
I don't think no one thought we were getting MVP.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Is that great on Phil's part that you got, you know, Derrick Rose? I love Porzingis. That worked out. But other than that, like, what has Phil really done for the Knicks?
Why can't Phil get escorted out the Garden? How can we make that happen? Can Phil get roughed
up
and escorted out?
It's not like you can take over a team and then all of a sudden make magic happen when you're left over, like, you know, with the situation that you have with, you know, not having draft picks certain years. So, I mean,
He didn't know that Joakim Noah was an injury prone former shell of himself.
Yeah, that was a bad move.
But that's the risk that you take the same way
you take the risk with Rose. But Noah giving him a long term deal, I don't see
that's
what
I'm saying.
The point
and even
was
with
that.
The, with Rose, Rose played really well the second half of last season. So, you know what I mean? Like, to bring him over, all right, that's one thing. But you knew that Joakim Noah was declining every year. He was getting hurt every year. So to sign him for that much, and I don't even care about the money, but the years that you put on him, that's a horrible sign. And then now look at he's not even playing. He's coming off the bench and I don't know. You got the young boys that's doing way better.
Especially since you had Hernan Gomez and everyone was very...
Yeah, but they didn't know what they had with Hernan Gomez, though.
Yeah, but, I mean, a lot of people were optimistic with him, figuring that it was going to work out good, and it turns out it did. So maybe, I mean, wasting the money on Noah was just a little ridiculous.
The years. I get the signing because, again, you didn't know what you had with Hernan Gomez. So it would have been a big risk to start the season with... you know, Hernan Gomez and O'Quinn as your two centers.
Yeah.
So they had to go and make the move, but the years. To give him a four-year deal, and now we're really stuck. No one's taking that off our hands.
Nope, because he's only going to get worse. It's not getting any better as the years go. Yeah. He's going to get older.
That's why if we do lose Melo, I would hope that we package Noah somehow.
That's the thing. No, who could afford to take both of those contracts? That was about $47 million between the two of them.
I know where Statman's going with this, so I got you back. All right. This is how it plays out for us, all right, people. So Phil goes to the Lakers.
Okay.
Then he does us the favor of taking Melo and Noah with him to the Lakers, and we get a first-round pick back from them, along with probably D'Angelo Russell to be our point guard of the future.
Would actually be really good for
them. And
then
Phil does us the biggest favor of all time.
Well, Melo wouldn't agree to that because there's no trade clause.
Hey, well, you're right because he doesn't want to go anywhere Phil's at.
Exactly.
Anyway,
so that really, all right.
That's a super trade by me. Yes. That's a bad trade. I'm living in La La Land.
I was hoping DeAndre Jordan and Jamal Crawford because the money works out with, you know, those if they traded Melo and Noah for Crawford and DeAndre Jordan, but who knows? Probably not going to happen. But moving back to the Oakley situation, Draymond Green had something to say. And he said that the Dolan-Oakley situation was you know, a slave master mentality. And that's, you know, kind of a bold statement there from Draymond Green. And
I think we're used to those kind of statements.
Yeah, I think it's Draymond a little ridiculous personally.
At this point,
what do you think, Tripp?
All right, here's the thing. When I understand the concept of that, not necessarily in this situation, but as far as with, you know, athletes in general, because, you know, people that make that reference is you have these the rich billionaire owners, with the exception of, you know, Michael Jordan, of course, now, who control the lives of, you know, especially in basketball, predominantly African-American sport. And you pretty much look at these players like they're livestock. They're working for you as long as they can produce for you. And then once they can't produce for you anymore, you feel like they have no value, you just get rid of them. So I understand when people use that reference. Now, in this particular situation, you know, although I do feel like, you know, James Dolan was doing a bit much bringing, you know, Larry Johnson and Latrell Sprewell to sit next to him after the whole thing went down with Oakley. Like, that was kind of one of those situations where it was like, no, I'm not a racist. Look, I got, you know, a couple of black friends too. So I thought, you know, that, you know, but as far as, you know, the slave master mentality, it's a little bit different in this situation. So I wouldn't really put it towards this. But, you know, James Dolan, he has a lot of work to do. You know, I'm not with the, you know, you calling Charles Oakley an alcoholic or you insinuating that he's that. Like, you haven't even had a conversation with the man. So how do you know what he is? Even, you know, and Oakley says he's trying to reach out to, you know, James Dolan before. But if you haven't even had a conversation with this man, how do you know he's an alcoholic? You're not in this man's personal life. Somebody could have told you that, or you may have heard rumors, but you don't know him like that to be even insinuating something like that, you know? So it's a lot going on. But that, again, man, that's what the Knicks have come to. And that's why I say the Knicks will not win while James Dolan is the owner of that team. It's pretty much all about the money. And that's why, you know, he doesn't look out for any of these legendary Knicks players. Mm-hmm. You know, yes, you know, Starks works with the team and Houston works with the team, but when you have Patrick Ewing, when you have, you know, Anthony Mason,
the job Oakley with Orlando and stuff.
Nah.
Listen, Patrick Ewing has been coaching for a long time, and I'm pretty sure if the Knicks went to Pat and said, "Yo, we want you to come be an assistant coach or help out, do something with the team," Pat would have came back. Like, this city made Patrick Ewing, and Patrick Ewing really made the Knicks.
I mean, I would love that. I'm the biggest Patrick Ewing fan.
But that's what I'm saying. Why has Patrick Ewing not been back in any capacity with the Knicks? He's a coach in the NBA, but has never been any kind of assistant on the Knicks organization. You had Herb Williams.
We had Herb Williams.
Herb Williams on this. Who was Herb for Williams? Years. What did Herb Williams do for the Knicks, that man? Nothing.
Well, Dolan, he really wants no affiliation with anybody that was part of the Knicks before he became the owner.
And that's the sad part.
And I think that's evident by the fact that they've groomed Allen Houston to be in the front office for years now. And John
Starks
never got that chance.
All he did was take $110
million. Yeah, John Starks never got that chance. Patrick Ewing. No one that was with the Knicks prior to 97, 98 has gotten those same opportunities. He only keeps the guys around him that were part of his Knicks squad. Larry
Johnson.
Yeah,
but Ewing was there in the last, you know, the later years too.
But that breakup was ugly anyway. You know, when Patrick got traded away, it was ugly.
Everyone blamed Patrick Ewing. I couldn't believe that because, you know, like I said, I'm a big Pat fan, but at the same time, it wasn't his fault that they lost. Like, I mean, you know, even in 94 when they lost and they blamed him, you know, he scored 30-something points. He knocks down a three-pointer in the corner trying to catch up because Starks and everyone else was missing threes. So he said, hey, let me put up a three and hits it. And, you know, but that's just the way it is. The star player always gets the blame, and that was the case with Patrick Ewing. So now we're seeing it with Carmelo Anthony. Probably, in my opinion, maybe more deservingly so. But
yeah, because I mean, we were even like during Patrick Ewing's run with the Knicks, you know, he was a top center in the league, you know. So he definitely put in a lot of work. But all of those guys, like I said, with Oakley and Mace, like, those were New York legends. Those four guys. You know, so for them to not really be embraced and be a part of the New York Knicks organization, that really, you know, it just sums up what the Knicks are, man, and why they are like that. Because you're not paying that back. It was Wade who was saying, you know, look at how they treating these guys. Like, this could be anybody. Because this is, you know, a lot of times sometimes this is what you have. Like, these teams, they don't mess with you. When they don't need you or you don't have any value to them, they'll throw you away. And that's, yo, why is Patrick? And I'm not even a Knicks fan.
I mean, that's a Dolan thing. I mean, I don't know if we can use that statement for every owner, because there are a lot of other owners who embrace the past.
Yeah, well,
Pat Riley screwed Dwayne Wade over. But.
Did he really screw him over, though?
But then he was with the Knicks, too, so it probably rubbed off on him from when he was with the Knicks.
Nah, I think those are two separate scenarios. But there are a lot of owners who embrace the past, and James Dolan just refuses to.
Yeah.
That's what it really what it comes down to. I don't agree with Draymond Green's comments about the slave master mentality, but yeah, I do feel that James Dolan is like, hey, look, you weren't one of my guys. You weren't here when I was the owner, or you weren't a fan favorite when I was the owner. So I can care less.
Yeah.
That's why he's, and your comment about Sprewell and Johnson. Those were two guys that were fan favorites during his early part of his ownership.
But you know what it is? The thing is that you should be trying to, you know, do something for the fans. It's like everything is about the dollar with you. You're not trying to win for the fans. At least give the fans. Like, we're talking about staples in Knicks history with these gentlemen and what they mean to the fans of New York City.
That's
exactly why things are working out the way they are working out.
Oh, for sure.
He's stubborn.
He does not care.
He's stubborn. Business is business, and he's great at that. And you can't take that away from him. He's great at business.
Is he really?
And making money. Well, he did come in the money. Well, he's great at sustaining it.
Okay.
I'll say that. And he's generating, you know, some revenue. I mean, the last 3 years, you got the Knicks at the highest, you know, valued franchise in the NBA. So he's definitely doing something right. But as far as being able to win, that's not something he doesn't know how to do. And he probably doesn't know how to do that because of the fact that he didn't earn it. He just had everything thrown to him. So he just doesn't know.
It's disgusting. It's a complete
joke. But again,
joke.
I'm not a Knicks fan, so all the
shout out to Jerry for writing in from Queens. He said, with all the drama going on, and the Knicks are still the highest value team in the NBA, so why can't they get things together on the court?
Because Dolan doesn't care about that.
Exactly.
They can't find the right chemistry. Yep. They can't find the right play calling, coaching, whatever you want to call it.
Everything.
The talent seemed like it was going to be promising this year, and it just didn't seem to click.
They don't have the right.
They go and
boys,
beat the Spurs, you know, then they lose. They have a double-digit lead against OKC yesterday, and then they lose that. So you just really, you really can't predict anything with the Knicks. Like, they're just no consistently there whatsoever. We have the video of the Oakley situation, and you know when it did happen. You know, I don't agree with Oakley putting his hands on the security guard, but at the same time,
they were crowding him and they were touching him at that point. And
I think he was the one that touched him first.
No, they were reaching him out, and he was started swatting their hands away.
There was actually footage recently that right before this, where he actually gets knocked over by the security guard.
That's the first thing I see with him mushing his head, but I guess the footage before that I didn't see, because that's
before that he put
the finger to the head and he mushed his head.
More importantly, so. Dolan is protecting his lady guest down there.
Yeah,
you know, because that's what really matters.
He's being chivalrous.
That's what really matters. Let me not diffuse the situation.
Phil
just woke up from a nap. He has no idea what's going on.
Yo, this is so crazy, man. Like, oh my goodness. Look at that.
Look at Bob. Former Nick.
Yo, so everybody, yo, this is, I'm sorry, man. I hate to laugh at the video.
Please
put this back up. Please.
Show
Doc's
reaction, please. Get to Doc with Doc and just like, really? We're just trying to play a game.
Who's also a part of that Knicks?
Just trying to play a game here.
This is really crazy. Oh my goodness.
Look at Dolan trying to pretend like he's having a conversation down there.
Yep. Nope. He knows exactly what's going on right now. He's like,
that's like when somebody's calling your name, but you don't want to respond. Yeah. You try to look away.
Yeah, try to look away. Oh my goodness! Like this is. I mean, I really hate that this happened to Charles Oakley, man. That really sucks. But you know,
I mean, obviously the Knicks statement was that he was screaming things at Dolan before security came. regardless
of course
of
that's
going to
be the statement because what we're going to say, nothing happened and James Dolan was just nervous because
he
saw
Oakley. But then they fired the security guard for handling the situation. So was the security guard, they're saying it's Oakley's fault. Then they fired the security guard.
And you see Adam Silver there, and
a pick of Jordan, who coincidentally both of them got together to kind of get the peace going on that situation. Michael Jordan, former teammate with Charles Oakley when he was on the Bulls, he was actually one of his favorite teammates. So when they traded him for Bill Cartwright, he wasn't too happy about that, but still friends with Oakley, trying to get into the mix over here and calm things down. And still not enough, apparently, because Oakley wants a public apology, and rightfully so. But the ban has been lifted, and the Knicks fans will move on until the next drama and catastrophe.
until Derrick Rose goes missing again.
Don't
you put that on me, Ricky Bobby.
You know what's really sad about this, right? Like, two of the NBA greats who tortured the Knicks, and Michael Jordan and Reggie Miller, they even feel this is bad.
Yeah.
These were guys who took pride in killing the Knicks every season. And they both feel bad for us.
Yo, this, like they, oh, I love this so much.
That's
oh,
like
my
a dude
goodness.
Just fighting with your whole life.
Yo.
Like saying, hey, I heard about what's going on with you and your lady. Oh, I feel really bad about this for you. It's just, oh my gosh.
Oh, this is, I think, man, this is, you know, been one of my favorite shows of all time. And we're only halfway through, man. I love what's going on here, man.
Y'all still
just,
don't want to trade us Kevin Love for
Melo? Nah, man, nah. Unless y'all going to take James Jones and Jordan McRae.
Is it James Jones on the one-year deal? Maybe we might do it. He's on a 1 year deal, so we might do it.
No love for Melo, except in the All-Star case, because Love was out, and he is going to be replaced by Carmelo Anthony.
Mm-hmm. I love Melo, and I hope he gets out of town. I hope he leaves.
I mean, listen, I would be happy. I would love to have Melo on the team. I'm just not trying to give up Kevin Love to get Melo. So, you know, if they can maneuver, I would love to have Melo play on the Cavs.
But since Kevin Love didn't play, do you think Carmelo Anthony was the right choice to fill in that spot?
They had to give him something.
No, he wasn't the right choice.
All the stuff going down.
He wasn't the right choice.
They just felt bad for him. It's like,
who would
you
think?
Bradley Beal.
Now, they said this on ESPN First Take, Max Kellerman and Stephen A. Smith, that they said Bradley Beal. Some other people say Bradley Beal. You have seven guards already on the team. Kevin Love was a forward. Melo's a forward.
How many centers do we have on the team? We don't care about that, right? Because we vote them in as forwards.
Yeah, because then that's just front court players
now.
Yeah,
so how many forwards on the team?
I mean, who else, as far as a big man, would I really want if not Melo? I mean, I think the Melo pick is more so for the fans.
That's Adam Silver saying, look, I know what's going on. Let me just get you out of New York for the weekend.
Yeah, this is olive bridge,
Let me get you out of New York for the weekend.
It's hot. You know, they got this stuff going on with Oakley. You know, we got to give Melo something. They had to give Melo something.
I mean, I'm happy for him, but Bradley Beal was more deserving. Bradley Beal was on a good team.
Yeah.
Putting up good numbers. Yes. I mean, we always talk about.
And Melo's the best player on a bad team. So.
On a very bad team.
Yeah. Well, performance-wise, they are underperforming. But
it would definitely be small ball, though, if we, you know, went with Bradley Beal as well.
It's going small ball now.
Yeah, that's pretty much what the league.
Extra small ball. Extra small ball.
Except for the East.
LeBron?
It was going to be Kevin Love, so.
Yeah, Kevin Love would have been playing center.
Who's playing center for the East?
That's about it.
Millsap?
Probably. Well, I mean, Millsap is there. Yeah, I don't know who else could.
That's it. It's just going to be LeBron.
So, small ball anyway.
Yeah, he's going to be playing.
That's what I'm saying. I don't know why we're pretending like it matters that he was a big man.
Well, you
could
probably put LeBron in there.
Well, yeah, that's what I said. LeBron's going to have to play the five now. That's fine. He can do it. It's all-star
game. You got the Greek freak over there. Jimmy Butler. I counted Jimmy Butler as one of the guards, even though he plays three. But, you know,
well,
I don't know. I can't. I don't think adding another guard and having eight guards on the team, on the All-Star team makes sense. Bradley Beal, obviously the Wizards are balling now. His numbers he's putting up good numbers. Melo's putting up similar numbers. He's just doing it on a losing team.
Wouldn't you rather Melo have the weekend off? I mean, without luck, Wouldn't you rather have him have the weekend?
I like the fact that we still technically have an all-star represented by the Knicks.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, but that's like the pity, you know, like we didn't have any other choice and then you can like the
other four prom days canceled on you.
It's yeah.
Melo could have stayed home.
He could have, but you know what? I don't mind seeing Melo play in the All-Star game. It should be interesting this year's All-Star game.
We've talked about the Knicks enough, sadly.
Man. All right, fine. Let's move on, guys.
Moving along. Mayweather says the McGregor super fight is not even close to happening. On Valentine's Day, he said, have your people call my people and let's make this happen, as if it's that simple. But
it's not going to happen.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, as much like I really just want to see Mayweather just win, just because I'm so tired of hearing the MMA fighters that think they're just going to go over to boxing and just dominate the best boxers. Like, that doesn't make sense to me. Like, if you were that good of a boxer, why were you not boxing already and making real money? Because nobody is making money in UFC who's not named Conor McGregor or Ronda Rousey.
Well, there's a lot of boxers who don't make money, too.
They're still making a whole lot more than MMA fighters.
No, not if you're at the bottom of the barrel.
When McGregor's at the top of the barrel, and he's probably making as much as somebody who's, like, mid-tier in boxing.
Yeah, but, I mean...
It's not going to happen. Dana White's not letting it happen.
I think that's really what it's going to be, because he can't eat off of it.
Yeah, Dana, and that's what it really comes down to. Dana White is the only promoter in the UFC, and he's going to want a big chunk of this. So if he gets a big chunk, then there's no way Conor gets close to the number that he wants.
Exactly.
It's not happening.
Dana White isn't going to want it to happen because Conor McGregor is going to get demolished.
Yeah, but I don't even think that matters.
And it's going to make UFC look even, you know, look worse.
I don't even think that matters to them. I just think it's really about the money. Yeah. If Conor goes over and has the success that he think, in the box office-wise, that he's going to have doing boxing, you know how many other UFC guys are going to think the same thing?
Is Conor not allowed to fight because of his contract?
I think Dana White has rights to any fight that he's a part of.
Yeah, so, part of the issue.
And that's the thing. Dana knows if Conor goes and has great success, Nate Diaz is a good boxer. So what's going to stop him from going over?
Yeah, there's a lot of guys.
You know, then there's
going
to be a lot of guys who say, hey, if I can go over there
and get
make
a couple
quick
million,
$5-7 million a night, why wouldn't I?
Because I'm not making that.
Yeah. No, they're not making that in the Octagon. Guys... No disrespect to what they do, but they're not making that type of
money. You'd have to fight Mayweather in order for that to work out.
No,
really.
Not necessarily.
I mean, there's other fighters out there, but they're not going to take those fights because they're looking to fight actual boxers.
You still got, you fight a Danny Garcia. You're going to still get a way better check than you were going to get before the Viv.
You're going to get the four wipes with you, and Danny Garcia probably isn't going to want to waste his time with you. It's a huge paycheck because of the idea of the UFC and Mayweather's name that makes that a tremendous paycheck. But I don't know if other fighters
are talking about
really...
It would have to be the top name fighters like in the UFC, because obviously nobody who's not even known in the UFC is going to come to boxing and get anybody with any kind of name anyway. So it would have to be one of those guys that's known. Or, you know, like if Ronda Rousey, you know, back when Leila Ali was fighting or something like that, it would only the top people in the MMA are going to actually.
It's not going to happen. I mean, I think it's great crossover appeal.
Yeah,
but it's not going to happen. Dana White is going to shut it down, and like I said, those
because he was trying to do it because he was talking about the $25 million each or whatever, so that he could eat off of it. And if that ain't the case, then it's going to be harder to pack.
Mayweather's just brilliant as a businessman because he understands if he could make this happen. You know how many UFC guys would want to go under Mayweather Promotions?
Yep.
Just for the sake of a payday in boxing once or twice?
Exactly.
They would all look at it like, all right, now there's another avenue for me to be successful.
Yeah.
I don't have to rely on Dana White. I could let Floyd promote a couple fights for me in the next few years and have the same type of appeal.
Exactly. And if it's about the money, I'm pretty sure Floyd would not mind promoting MMA fights.
Of course not.
It's definitely a good look, you know, from the business standpoint for Mayweather. But yeah, if he's not getting anything out of it, if Dana White's not getting anything out of it, I don't know if it's gonna happen.
It's not happening.
Because that was one of the things that Floyd said. He said, you know, take care of what you got to take care of over at the UFC, and then we can talk. And so we got to wait and see if that's going to actually happen. Like I said, I would love to see it happen. I would love to see Mayweather and Conor McGregor in the ring and just to be able to shut all that down, you know, and take it from there. But I doubt it.
I doubt it's going to happen as well, but hopefully it does. I'd like to see Conor get his butt whipped. But moving along, speaking of boxing, Adrian Broner back in the ring Saturday. What's your take on that trip?
I just hope, you know, you never know what you're going to get from Adrian Broner.
Former mini Mayweather.
Yeah, exactly. You know, if he's doing well, I think he should be able to win the fight. If he's not, you know, I mean, you know, we were just not too long ago, we were talking about him and you know, the whole suicide and all of that stuff. So I don't know which Adrian Broner we're going to get in the situation. But if you know, if he's ready to go, I don't see why he shouldn't be able to get a win in this fight.
Yeah, I don't know what we're getting from AB, honestly. He's one of the most frustrating fighters to watch.
He really kind of like the Knicks.
I mean, worse, because he actually has skill.
Yeah.
But he's a very lazy fighter.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? So a lot of times he's just fighting flat-footed, and he's just relying on pure ability. So, Statman, you know, because you know the sport, he's just a very lazy fighter. Yeah. So that's what I say, you never know what you're going to get from him. Like, mm-hmm. I remember when he fought Sean Porter a few years ago, and he looked really good against Sean Porter. But then you look at other times, and you're like, what is this guy doing in the ring?
Yeah, like,
so you never know what you're going to get with him. He should win this fight, but we really don't know.
Well, if he does, he'll probably have his girlfriend brush his waves in the middle of the ring again, and that's always exciting.
That's how you got to do it. All right, so we didn't get a chance to talk about the Super Bowl last week. We had a snow day, but the Patriots having the biggest comeback in Super Bowl history. They had their parade. Tom Brady is, you know, obviously goes down in history as one of, if not the best quarterback in the history of the game. He, you know, added another notch on his belt, so to speak, and, you know, pulling together that comeback, obviously, whether you love him or hate him, it's definitely impressive. Mm-hmm. And Patriots getting it done. And we have a few players not wanting to go to the White House. And we got Ryan from Trenton, New Jersey, wrote in, what do you guys think about players choosing not to go to the White House after winning a championship? Now, the list, it started with Bennett and McCourty. And now we add Long, Blunt, Hightower, Branch, and James White to the mix. So we're looking at a total of seven, which started at two. I mean, everyone has different reasons. You know, some it's, you know, family. And, you know, I mean, I personally, if you have the opportunity to go to the White House, that's your choice. I think it's a opportunity that doesn't come along every day. If you want to choose to miss out on that for political reasons or whatever the case may be, that's your opinion. I don't personally have a problem with it. But if I won the Super Bowl, I would want to go to the White House. That's just my opinion. But
I mean, I would want to go to the White House, but I do feel those guys, depending on who is there, I might not want to go to the White House. So I could definitely understand that. I mean, it all kind of sucks because it's like, well, you might not get back there again. But even if you do, if you wasn't trying to go right now for Trump, you know, we're only the first year in for 4 years. No. So if you're older, one of those older guys on the team, you might not get another opportunity, you know, to go. But, you know, I definitely feel where they're coming from. You know, Chris Long, is the only Caucasian football player on that list. But he definitely spoke out a couple of months ago. You know, when everything was going down, you know, with Kaepernick, when that whole protest first started, and, you know, with the police in Dallas and all of that, he definitely spoke out. So I can understand, like, you know, but it's not the first time this happened, you know. When the Patriots won last year, Tom Brady didn't go.
2 years ago.
Two years ago, Tom Brady didn't go. So and players do this all the time. They said, if it's not somebody, you know, who you wanted to be in office, you know, you might not go.
Yeah, but Tom Brady, did he Did he go the time before that? Because he's, you know, he's been there quite a few times.
Yeah, he went when George W. was in.
But did he go? Did he go in the Obama administration?
No, they didn't. That was before.
Yeah, Giants knocked him off. Those times.
That is true.
Yeah.
So, thank you for reminding me.
So
hope
I mean,
that brightened up the day a little.
Yeah, all that negative Knicks talk. We get to go remind myself.
You definitely,
the Giants, you know,
you got one in there. You know,
all the memes out there after the Patriots win the Super Bowl. Congratulations that they could win the Super Bowl against everyone but the Giants.
And that was and I was sitting watching the game. This is what I'm thinking the whole time as the Falcons are up 28-3, and I'm just like, dang, man, Eli might not be the only person to beat Tom Brady. I'm not gonna be able to use that anymore. And I really wanted to use that. So when they came back, I was like, yes, Eli's still the only one to beat the Patriots in the Super Bowl twice. So you gotta look. I know that's the wrong reason for me to be rooting for them to come back, but I don't care. You gotta take the small victories, man.
The Giants fans out there that can be excited. Ladybug is in the building. She will be joining us. I know a lot of you out there get a little mad at us on social media, tweeting that she's not making an appearance. She is in the building unless she wants to be,
She's fancy. She's fancy today. She's very
bougie and decide not to join us on TV.
So, we hope she does. You know what, Cliff, can we do this, actually, Cliff, so we can give Ladybug a second to come out? Could we actually, when you get a second, could you pull up the website and show everybody where they can go exactly to see Eric's blog so we can give Ladybug a chance to get out here? Make sure you guys check out the blog and everything else that's going on the website. That's Real Fans, Real Talk. .com, facebook.com/ Real Fans Real Talk if you want to hit us up on there. On Twitter and Instagram, it's at Real Fan Talk. And if you guys just want to go back and forth, you want to talk about what's going on with Oakley and the Knicks, you know, being so horrible, you can get us in the Facebook group. We go back and forth in there all the time, you know. So just hit us up on the social media. We also have Ballin' for Pieces coming up very soon, March 4th. It's going down at York College. It won't be at St. John's anymore. It's actually going to be at York College. And next week, H2O is actually going to come through and help me co-host since Statman won't be here. So we're going to talk more about Ballin' for Peace next week when we have H2O and D Chambers will both be in the building next week. But you know what it is, man. When we get to those Ballin' for Peace basketball games, those are some of the best times of the year because everybody comes out and it's all for a great cause. So, you know, if you guys haven't already gotten your tickets, make sure you guys hit up H2O, hit up the Ballin' for Peace on Instagram, or you can reach out to any of us, myself, Statman, or Ladybug, and we'll point you guys in the right direction. But you do not want to miss Ballin' for Peace because there are some heavy hitters that will be playing in this year's game. So, you know, just to name a few, I'm gonna give y'all a few. I ain't gonna give y'all everybody that's gonna be there, but you got Fred the Godson is gonna be there, and Jaque. You got my son, you got Fresher. So if y'all wait a minute, y'all know the song, he's gonna be in the building. Tara from Love and Hip Hop is gonna be in the building. Bianca from Love and Hip Hop, New York is gonna be in the building. So it's gonna be a whole lot of people that's coming out to support Ballin' for Peace. And then plus everybody here, the whole Real Fans, Real Talk family will be in the building as we always are, supporting Haran and everything
that
he does.
Real Fans, Real Talk website up there.
So once we get that, and then you guys can check it out. But definitely make sure you guys hit the site up, realfansrealtalk.com, and check out that blog. All right? All you got to do, go to where it says blogs, and then click on Eric Sanchez, Legend in Two Games, all that. The blogs are there. You might want to go back.
It's right there on the top right.
There you go, right there.
That's the homepage. If you go back to the homepage, you can see the title, Jokes on Us. You see the Joker himself, James Dolan in the corner there with the Knicks logo in the background. And very good read. It is rated R, though.
Yes.
I apologize for that. I allowed my frustration
to spill
over.
Keep the children with blinders on. You know how, like, when you're in the car with your parents and the music is playing and you tell them to put this song on, but they got mad curses, so you got to cough every time? You know, you got to kind of do something like that.
Go back to the homepage. They might be able to read, you know, some of the profanity from the upset Knicks fan here. So there it is, realfansrealtalk.com, and you can check out our old episodes and previous blogs and posts out there.
Petro.
I mean, you know, they do hold us down. You know, they definitely make sure our charity events, you know, go through as planned. So shout out to Petro, you know, for sponsoring Real Fans Real Talk and
bunch
all
of
our
other great
endeavors in the community.
Episodes, but you know, everyone's waiting for Ladybug, so without further ado, yeah. The one and only Ladybug.
She's all fancy. She got long hair, don't care.
It's been so long. Yeah, I've actually, I dressed up, so I just want to let everybody know I'm here. I'm back.
She had to make up, guys, for, you know, missing out, you know, the last, you know, couple
of shows.
You know,
Tuesday was Valentine's Day, so, and I actually had to work on Valentine's Day. I had to work. I didn't get to be all gushy and mushy like a lot of people. I had to work. So I'm kind of trying to make up for it now because I didn't get to see you guys in a few weeks. But I miss you guys.
You know what? I'm not even going.
You see, Trip likes to start every time. And then when I'm late, it gets worse. I'm not here, it's worse.
Listen, you know, I don't know what's
going on. Because we get the backlash from all the fans.
I'm sorry, social media. I'm sorry, guys. I'm here. I'm going to do this. Let's start this room with me one time. You already know. So what's going on? It's your favorite Ladybug. I am here. I'm back. I never left. I was doing things, but you know, I always come back. This is my home. Ladybugs always come home. Little known fact. Anyway, first and foremost, I'm in a good mood. So I want to say congratulations to Derek Jeter and his wife. They're having their first child, and it's a girl. Mm-hmm. So shout outs. Derek Jeter, he going to be good with that bat in a few years. Next 15, 20 years, that bat's going to come to use.
El Capitan, congrats.
It's going to be like Bad Boys. Remember the Bad Boys movie? Mm-hmm. You look 30. Yep. That's what's going to happen. But, you know, it's always great when, you know, celebrities get to share personal things in their lives. You know, also shout out to Beyonce. You know, the Beehive is real anywhere you go in any aspect of life. So, you know, we have to give congratulations to Beyonce also. And, you know, she killed it at the Grammys. But that's neither here nor there. We're going to get into these rumors. So, I remember a few weeks ago, you guys heard me announce Brock Lesnar was coming out of retirement. He's going to do UFC. He's going to fight. You know, he's back into it. He had a whole interview about it. But Brock Lesnar is retiring again.
So I guess we'll be seeing Brock Lesnar.
He can't make up his mind.
And that's what it was. And he was suspended for a suspicion of, you know, illegal substances. And he would have been off of this suspension July of 2017. But since he did retire, they don't have to keep him on the, you know, the drug registrar, as they say. Because when you do get suspended, they keep, you know, tabs on you to make sure you're clean and you're ready to fight. But since he retired, he's off that list. And this week they announced that he's going to put in his retirement. He's going to retire again.
Now, is he going back to WWE or?
I think he's going to hang it up for good. I think he's just going to hang up all fighting in general.
He got some good checks out of Vince McMahon, though.
I'm saying, McMahon is, you know, he is a good employee.
He's probably feeling a little salty that he made Goldberg beat him.
Yeah.
After Goldberg hasn't been around for 10 years. And
they're fighting at WrestleMania.
Fighting at WrestleMania too.
First of all, shout out to Cliff.
Shout out to Cliff.
This, you know what? It's a bunch of grown men that's huge wrestling fans still.
We are wrestling fans. That's all. So we know.
Yo, it's shout out to Cliff though, man.
Goldberg was that dude back then. I had to tune in to see Goldberg.
He definitely was.
So yeah, so you know, once again, Brock Lesnar is retiring from MMA. This is the second time he's going to officially retire. He put all the paperwork in to let go and just, you know, let them know that this is it. I'm going to take my career elsewhere. I don't feel like he should have came back for that one fight when he knew he was doing what he was doing. You know, it's suspicion, so I can't say it's facts, but allegedly,
if the piss don't ship, you must have quit. As a ghost, that's how the saying goes. There you go.
So, you know, with that being said, I just hope whatever he does from this point on, it benefits him, you know, as a person, makes him happy and things like that. Also, update, I know a few weeks ago we were talking about Nick Young and how he was going into this court issue with his former manager because the manager was telling him that he didn't keep up to his 2% agreement before he got his NBA contracts and things like that. And actually, update on that, what ended up happening is that Nick Young is ended up to pay that former manager almost $700,000 in these legal costs and things like that. And mind you, that's 2%. Usually managers ask for 10, 12, 15. That's 2% that he was asking for before he got signed to the NBA. And that equaled up to $700,000. So crazy. Imagine if it was a manager once he got signed. That would have easily been over $1 million that manager would have got. But the fact that he got that was because Nick Young never showed up for court. All the times that they were scheduled for court, he never showed up. Oh, so when you don't show up for court, it automatically goes to the other, you know, to the, you know, the defendant.
Swaggy P ain't got time for court.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? He doesn't have time for court. The Lakers possibly, you know, his contract is good. You know, so he told that manager, take your 2% of what I had back then, because the 2% of what I got now ain't nothing. So I guess, you know, Nick Young, I don't know how he felt about it, but... You know, that old manager, he's getting almost $700,000. I don't know what he's going to do with it. I don't know if he's still trying to continue to teach future NBA players or whatnot. But that's that. There is some Mayweather news, but I'm going to keep up on that with a later show. Because, you know, it's Mayweather versus the world here. So we got to keep up on that. But as always, make sure you follow me, realfansrealtalk.com. Follow the Rumor Mill and on social media.
All right. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. And make sure you're following us on social media at realfansrealtalk, facebook.com/realfansrealtalk. We're going to do the final thought. Eric, you got anything you want to add?
Keep the Knicks in your prayers tonight.
Yes.
Please do. We really need that right now. Read the blogs. Keep tuning in. We can't get a prayer.
Trip.
I
love it when a good thing's come. All right, we're going to pray for the Knicks right
can
now.
We
all right.
All right, can quick. We dim these lights a little bit.
5 second prayer. Let's go.
Bow all right. Heads. Bow your heads, everybody.
Bow
all
for right. Knicks.
And we're going to do this. Dear basketball gods, please help the Knicks. They are desperate, for they know not what they do. Forgive them, please.
They don't.
And allow
they really
the Knicks
don't.
To maybe, just maybe, make the eighth seed. And whether they trade Carmelo Anthony or not, just allow them to be good and allow them to be understanding and allow the fans to have some understanding as well. Please take the pressure off of the fans because it is them that truly hurts behind everything that goes on with the New York Knickerbockers. We ask these and all blessings.
And please guide them through the path of non-stupidity.
Deliver them from evil.
Amen.
Deliver them from stupid decisions. Amen.
Amen.
I really like your passion.
That was a serious. That was a
you
serious
know I get
prayer for the
Knicks. That was deep. That was
Trip,
deep,
Trip went deep in his.
You
in
know,
his
the church here.
I got some words
talk.
For y'all, man.
That was
I got
the real
words.
Fans, real talk soul right there. That was that was real.
You know.
Definitely.
Let's get up out of here, Stan, man.
With that being said, for Ladybug, Eric Sanchez, and Trip Young, I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. Thanks for joining us on this edition of Real Fans Real Talk, and we'll see you next time, everyone.
Good night.
Peace.
God bless you. And the Knicks.
And the Knicks. Jeez, we need it.
Oh.
RealFansRealTalk.com. With Arthur Domus, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log on to the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell a Bobby sent ya from spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda.